So dare to be different is the message today. Joshua chapter 24, verse 15 says this. Joshua is talking to the children of Israel before they go into the promised land. He says, if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day who you will serve, whether the gods of your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose lands you're living. But as for me and my household, we will what? We will serve the Lord. I love that courage of Joshua. I love the tenacity of his spirit. And he's talking to several million of the children of Israel. He says, if serving other gods seems good, go do it. But for me, I don't know about you, but I'm going to serve the Lord. How many of you, that is your declaration over your family? I'm going to serve the Lord. 1 Peter 2:9 says this, but you are God, you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into what? His wonderful light. In Hebrews 11 is our final verse for the morning. Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not yet see. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, speak to our hearts. Challenge us today by your word to live by faith, to trust in you, God. Help us to be different in your name. Amen, amen. You may be seated. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's going to be a good word today. So listen up. I don't know if you've ever felt the pressure to fit in. Have you ever in your life felt the pressure to fit in? Maybe at your job or a place of employment, you feel like you have to be a certain person or dress a certain way or act a certain way, but I'm sure many of us felt this way in middle school or high school. Anybody feel a need to fit in? Peer pressure is such a strong thing when you're growing up and finding your identity. And I don't know about you, but I struggle to fit in sometimes. I tried to fit in with the crowd to feel like I was a part of the group or accepted. This may come as a real surprise to you, but I wasn't the coolest kid in junior high. Why are you laughing, Billy? I know you're shocked by that. And so I was a little bit on the nerdy side, just put it that way. And so I really tried to fit in because I wanted to be accepted, and I didn't get any of the dates. And I was never elected the prom king or the class representative. And one year, I think I've shared this story before, one year I was actually asked to escort the girls down the steps. And I was like, ooh, well, there's my shot, right? I get to actually hold their hand on the way down. But I tried to fit in. I did my best. And so I remember I went out to try to get clothes. Gennaro was the big clothes back then. And we had Miami Vice and all the cool. So I think I have a picture of how cool I looked when I went out and got. Do you have a picture of me there? Put that up on the screen for us so we can see how I fit in. There we go. There's that kid that fit in seventh grade so well. Can you show the other one? Because the other one was me with my sister because I didn't have a date. But there we go. That's when I was asked to escort the young ladies. Now, is that guy cool or what? Let me tell you. Those glasses, I mean, they're in style. I don't know if you've ever struggled to fit in, but when we were kids, this whole you do you and be yourself and be different was not a thing, right? Come on, older generation, help the millennials out. You be you and be different and be as, that was not a thing back then. Back then, if you had big glasses like that, you were called Four Eyes. If you had braces, you were Metal Mouth. Come on, how many of you remember that bullying in school was like accepted? It was the norm. And if you go tell a teacher, like they're looking at you like, so they called you Metal Mouth, big deal. Generation was different back then, and fitting in was a hard thing to do. And nowadays, it's different. It's that new Mountain Dew commercial out is you be you or you do you. And it's encouraged. Be as different as you want to be. And that's accepted all around. And can I tell you something? That didn't come from this generation's idea. Did you know that God called his children to be different? God had called the children of Israel thousands of years ago. He said, you see the nations around you, how they live and how they behave. He said, I'm going to call you out of them. You are going to be different. It's no different today for God's children. He calls us to be different. When he spoke to the children of Israel and he brought them out of slavery, he told them, he said, listen, you're going to belong to me. And as he went into the desert before they got into the promised land, he set up a temple and he taught them how his presence could dwell among them and what they needed to do. And he taught them about purity. And if you read the Old Testament, you see that a lot of what God wanted to do in our hearts, once Christ came, they did outwardly. So they offered sacrifices for their sin. And they repented to the Lord, and they prayed, and if they touched anything unclean, they couldn't come into the temple. That was a representation of we're to be pure and be different. Listen, the children of Israel were different than the world around them. Their morality was different. They were monotheistic, which meant they believed in one God. They didn't worship a bunch of different gods. They didn't go looking for someone else to give them financial blessing and someone to give them fertility and have lots of children. And listen, they were different from the world around them. They didn't worship the same way. They didn't have the same behaviors, the same attitudes. In fact, God instructed them, when you enter the land, do not go intermarry with those around you, for they will lead your heart astray to other gods. The children of Israel were God's people, and they were to be, say it with me, say different. Joshua said this, if it seems good to you to go serve the gods of the other nations, you go do it. But as for me and my house, I will serve the Lord. He wasn't afraid to be different. 2 Peter said, we are called out of darkness into light. We're God's special possession. One version actually says it this way, we're a peculiar people. Aren't you glad you're peculiar? We're different. We're different. And so many times as believers, as Christians, we see that as a negative or a drawback. Sometimes we're embarrassed that we don't always fit in with the world around us. But can I let you know that we're called to be pulled out of the world? We're not to live in the world or of the darkness, but to be children of the light. And here's what I want to share with you this morning. It's okay to be different. It's okay for us as believers, as children of God, to be different. And this morning, I want to share just a couple ways in which we've been on a series of the Holy Spirit the last few weeks. And it's been challenging to me. I don't know about you, but the challenge of my heart is to not be complacent, to not miss out on what God has and let the Holy Spirit have my life. And I want to talk to you just about a few ways. I think this translates that living differently involves the Holy Spirit's work in our life. Amen? It involves the work of the Holy Spirit in leading us. But there's several very practical things that I want us to think about today about what it means to live differently. And the first one is this. So if you're taking notes, the first thing that we are different than the world is this. We put our faith in God. We are a people who walk by faith and not by what? Sight. We don't walk by fear. We don't walk by what we see in the natural realm. We're a people called to live by faith. And I want you to know something this morning. If you're a child of God, which means what? What does it mean to be a child of God? I told our youth all the time, I said, listen, everyone is God's creation, but we're not all God's children. Those who choose to accept his son Jesus have the right to become children of God. And so I teach our young people that, and here's what it means. If you're a believer, if you're a follower of Jesus, you're a child of God, here's what you need to know, that we can trust God with our life. That was an amen point. You missed it if you didn't catch it. We can trust God with our lives. God is a God who can hold our lives in his hands. In fact, the Bible tells us he directs our steps. He leads us. Psalm 37 says it this way, the Lord makes firm the steps of the one who delights in him. Another version says, the Lord orders the steps, guides the steps. You know what I love about that scripture? Is it's the steps are ordered of the Lord. Isn't it cool that God doesn't just say, hey, your goal is to go way over there. Good luck. I'll see you when you make it. Aren't you glad the Bible says God orders our what? Our steps. That means whatever I'm going through today, I just got to get to here and God's going to help me. And I just got to get to here and God's going to help me. Aren't you glad God is with you all the time? He's guiding our steps. He's giving us wisdom for today. Yes, give the Lord praise for his guidance in our life. It says, though he may stumble, he or she may stumble, he will not fail, for the Lord upholds him in his hand. We don't have to worry in our life because the Bible says that God holds the upright in his hands. He is the foundation of your life. He's a safety net. Have you ever seen the trapeze artists in the circus? And they're at the Barnum and Bailey Circus. I used to go watch it when I was a kid, and nowadays they do it without nets. But they used to have the big safety net. You remember that? Can I let you know, God has this big, huge safety net of your life called his hands. There's no way you can fall outside of God's safety. That's something you need to know as a child of God. In fact, the Bible goes a little further to help us understand that anxiety and worry is a sin against God. Think about that for a minute. If you're a child of God and you say, God, you can't handle this. This is too big for you. I'm anxious and I'm worrying and you can't have this. And we begin to take it in our hands. Guess what that is? That's a sin against God. It's telling God, you're not big enough in my life to help me through this situation. The Bible helps us understand that we're called to, in fact, Philippians 4 says this, do not be anxious about anything. Put your situation in there. Your illness, your family struggle, your betrayal, the gossip that's been going on, the attack that's come against your life. Come on, be practical for a minute. Every situation, it says be anxious. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, with prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And listen to what will happen. When you live that way, the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, it doesn't even make sense to people. You're going to have peace in the middle of situations. It will guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. Do you want to live with that kind of peace in your life? The Bible says don't be anxious for anything. It says, if you will make your request known to the Lord, the peace of God will guard your hearts. And here's what we got to know is the wicked have no such promise. The unrighteous, those who choose to live in sin, who reject God, they do not have a promise from God that they will have peace. They do not have a promise that God's will be done in their life. Have you ever heard people just say, oh, well, it must have been God's will? For the wicked, that is not the case. For those who are not children of God, there are consequences, things that come, circumstances that come to their life that are either the judgment of God or God saying, you've got this on your own, you have not accepted me. The wicked live in fear. They live in fear of loss. They live in fear of the future. They don't know what tomorrow holds. And to be quite honest with you, if I didn't have God guiding my steps, I have to say, I would be pretty anxious about the future. I'd be pretty anxious about losing the things that were dear to me, that were close. I would probably worry a great deal because I don't know what to do. And here's the worst part of it. Those who don't follow the Lord, guess what they have? Deep-seated in their heart, there's a fear of judgment. Because we know deep in our hearts. We might say, I'm a good person, and God can't possibly hold things against me. But deep in our hearts, we know that we're not right with God without Jesus. Come on. Does anybody agree in your heart that you know you need the grace of God in your life? Hebrews 10 says this, if we deliberately keep on sinning after we've received the knowledge of the truth, there's no sacrifice left for our sin, but only a fearful expectation of what? Say judgment. Did you know God will judge? He'll judge wickedness. And our hope and our grace is that we have grace in Jesus Christ and we can avoid the judgment that we deserve for sin. But listen, God is a just God. And so for those who don't have God, those who aren't following God, they don't have a hope of peace. In fact, it's judgment that comes. And here's what you've got to know as a child of God. You can make a decision to either walk by faith and trust in the Lord, or you walk by fear, and fear can drive our lives. Fear can cause us to make bad decisions, but God has called us to have faith. He's called us because we chose to believe in his Son, because we have chose to receive the grace of the cross and the forgiveness in our life. We're reconciled to the Father. Here's what you can have faith in. And hold on to this. Let this sink into your heart. You can have faith in the promise of eternal life. You can have faith in the promise that you are reconciled to the Father through Jesus Christ. You can have faith in the Romans 8 says this, that in all things that work together for your good for those who love him. Listen, you can have faith that God's going to work out things for your good because you love him. You can have faith that God is going to watch over you. And even if it seems like the circumstances are not working out, if you love the Lord, you can have faith in the promise that in the end, it's going to work out together for your good. Isn't that encouraging to know? that what you're going through today, God is able to work out for your good. But you don't understand, God can't possibly work this situation. Yes, he can. It doesn't matter what relationship, how far gone you think it is. It's never going to get fixed. The Bible says that for those who love him, God will work all things, the painful things, the hard things, the discouraging things, the struggling things of your life, together toward your good. How many of you want to have faith in God? That's how we're different. We're different from the world because we trust God with our lives. And listen, this isn't just some ethereal idea, because a lot of people say they have faith in God. Faith in God is very practical. Faith in God is a real thing that each day we choose to act based on our belief. We choose to act based on our promises that God has given us in light of what he's done for us. And here's what you need to know. When it comes to submitting our lives to God, when it comes to having faith in God, it's really an all or nothing proposition. You can't really have faith in God and say, listen, God, I trust you with forgiving my sins. Oh, but you can't have my relationships over here. Or God, I give you the needs of my life. I know that you're a good provider, but don't ask me for my money or to teach me about money. Faith in God means if you're God, either he's God or he's not. Amen? Either he's God and we can trust him with our lives, or he's not, and let's just work it out on our own. Faith is one of those all or nothing propositions. In fact, Hebrews 11 says this way, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Because those who come to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who, what? Diligently seek him. Sometimes your faith is proved out over time. Sometimes you ask God for something once and he's like, I've already got the answer, but it's going to be a couple months down the road. How many of you know faith comes in? We have to step out in faith and trust the Lord and go, you know what, God, I trust you. Because either he's God or he's not. And if he is, he's worth our trust. I understand sometimes it's tough to give our relationships to the Lord, our kids to the Lord, our families, our futures, our we want a spouse or someone to spend our life with, our family. It's tough to say, Lord, I'll just trust you with these areas of my life. I'll walk in obedience. But sometimes faith is a leap into just trusting God. Sometimes you got to just step out. If you remember Abraham and Isaac, if you know the story of Abraham and Isaac, Abraham was promised by God. Abraham cried out to the Lord and said, Lord, I want a son. I want to have a family. God said, because you've chosen to have faith in me, not only will I give you a son, but I'm going to give you nations. And guess what? 10 more years passed before he had the son of the promise. And you know what God did when he had the son of the promise? When Isaac turned 13 years old, God came to Abraham and he said, Abraham, I want you to give me your son back. I want you to sacrifice him to me. Now, here's the backdrop of the story. You got to understand, because Abraham had chosen faith. He'd chosen to trust the Lord. But Abraham, like you and I, sometimes he was human, right? He struggled a little bit in his faith. And so he left the land of his father. He went to the promised land, and he wandered around in the desert, basically. And the Bible says that he had faith to leave his parents' house and to trust God. But then when he got there, have you ever gotten somewhere and go, okay, let me take this back into my hands. Thank you for guiding me, Lord, but let me hold on to this a little bit. The Bible tells us about Abraham, how he began to have some fear. He got close to Egypt, and he was afraid that they were going to come and that Pharaoh was going to take his wife. So he lied. Instead of trusting the Lord, he lied and goes, this isn't my wife. This is Sarah, my sister. He was fearful and what ended up happening is Pharaoh took her and was going to make her his wife. And God came in a vision and goes, do not touch her. She belongs to Abraham. And not only did he do this once, but he did it twice. Abraham struggled a little bit with completely, any of you ever struggle a little bit with putting it all in God's hands? And so God needed Abraham to understand, you have to trust me completely. So he came to him and says, remember the son I promised you, the one you love, give him back to me. How many of you know that probably took a big step of faith for Abraham? Not just his wife and being fearful for his life. Now the one desire of his heart is right there. God had finally given him this promise. And God says, you know what? Do you really trust me? Put it back in my hands. Have you ever been to that place in your life where you had to trust the Lord? I want you to watch this video. This is an oldie but a goodie. If you turn your eyes to the screen.
Of God. leap from the lion's head.
How many know sometimes taking a leap of faith feels like that? You feel like you're stepping out and you just don't know what's going to happen. But can I give you an encouragement? When you trust the Lord, there's always going to be something there to meet you when you need it. God will always provide what is needed in your life. And God will test you to know. It's not so much for him to test, because the Bible says God knows the hearts of men. God already knows what's in our hearts. The reason God tests us is so that we will know if we truly trust in the Lord. Listen, some of us, we have a trouble trusting, putting our faith in God, because we're holding on to an area of our life that we say, I can't really give this to you, Lord. And the Holy Spirit is one of the roles of his in our life. One of his works is to help us believe, listen, I can trust in the Lord. My relationships, my personal life, my future, my dreams, my goals, my hopes, things haven't been turning out the way I thought they would, but if I'll put my faith in the Lord, I believe that good things are in store ahead for me. It's time for us, church, to put our faith in God. Come on, let's give the Lord a praise for his goodness to us. Faith is taking a leap into obedience to God. It's an action. Paul says, you can show me your faith, but I'll show you my faith by what I do. You can't really see faith. Faith is something that is exercised when we actually take action. So what does that mean for us? If we're going to walk by faith, those who say, I believe in God, and those who say, I put my faith in God, the difference is action. The difference is when God calls us to forgive, we forgive knowing that God is the one who is just and fair, and it's not up to me to hold it. Forgiveness is saying, God, I'm going to step out in faith, and you're the one who just, this person has hurt me, this person has betrayed me, but I'm going to forgive because your word says, and you're the one who makes all things right. I put it in your hands. That's the step of faith. It's an act of obedience. We submit to God. We follow him because we learn that his plan is best for our lives. We have peace in our hearts because we choose to say, God, my life is no longer going to be something I control, but it's going to be something you control, and the peace of God will guard our what? Hearts and minds. We give. We tithe. We serve in ministry. All of these things are an action showing that, God, I really believe that my life can be put in your hands, so I'm going to act on that. You know, our primary responsibility, here's what I want to encourage you to do today. Step out on faith in your life. Stop worrying about your future. Stop worrying about what you have right now that you're facing that seems like such a huge mountain in your life. If you'll trust in the Lord, you're going to look back maybe 5 years from now and look and go, that mountain was really just a molehill. It was so big to me then, but when I put it in God's hands, it really wasn't that big after all. And here's what I want to tell you. If the graduates were here, they're going to be here second service, but I think it applies to all of our hearts today. Don't fret or worry about your future. Come on, let me say it again. I want you to grit that in your mind. Don't fret or worry about your future. pursue your dreams. Live abundantly, one of our core values. Enjoy your life. Get married, stay single, have a family, or go do a career, pursue a career. Listen, your primary responsibility in life is to line yourself up with God's word and to trust in him. If you'll do that, you don't have to worry about, oh, what job am I going to do? What am I going to do? Or what happens if this? Or what happens if that? The Bible says all things are going to work out to your good anyway. So your primary responsibility is just to line yourself up with the Lord and go, okay, this is what God asks of me. Let me just do it and then put it in his hands. Isn't that a freeing way to live? That's how we're different from the world. We have faith in God, a genuine faith in God. We're so different from the world. By just claiming to believe in God, we actually choose to live by faith in God. So let your heart line up. Let your life line up. Let the Holy Spirit do his work and help you realize where I need to put this area under the Lord. Let him guide me in this area of my life. And once you do that, enjoy your life. Just trust that God is going to lead you. The second thing that we know as far as being different from the world, that we can see the difference in our life, is not only that we put faith in God, but the second thing we're different from the world is we obey God. Can I get an amen on that? Just to encourage me, just to let me know somebody's going to be with me on this one. It's not popular in our culture to say that we have to obey something. I do a lot of weddings, and let me tell you, the brides do not want me to say anymore, I will love and honor and cherish and obey the husband. We just take that out. Nowadays, there's not a bride who ever wants that in there. I can just pretty much take it to the bank. That one's out. We're not even doing that. Our culture does not want to be told to obey anything. We don't. It's against our fleshly nature. It's against our independent attitude and spirit. And listen, God made us to be independent. He made us to be able to have an energy about our life. But 1 Peter tells us, listen, you're a chosen people, a royal priesthood, but you are also a holy nation. That means you are set apart to God. If you're going to be a child of God, it's like this. You're in his clan, and that means that you come and live his way. Their obedience to the Lord is a part of us saying, God, I belong to your family. I belong to those who submit to you. And he says this, you're called out of darkness to live in his what? Wonderful light. You know what that means? That means we go from living however we want, feeling around in the darkness, to say, God, now I'm going to live under your light and follow your ways. Psalm 19 says it this way, your commands are radiant. They give light to my eyes. When God gives commands, they're not just so that we can have a checklist to see how we're doing with him. When God gives commands, he says, these are the parameters of your life. These are the ways to do things right. It's like you get a brand new car, and it tells you, put this kind of gas in it. And if you go out and put sugar in the gas tank, what's going to happen? You take it back to the dealership, and they're going to be like, we told you so. You know, how many of us, we live our lives in a way that just goes, I'm going to do what I want, and then we come to the Lord and go, God, my relationships are a mess. What do I do? And he says, I gave you commands. Follow my teaching. Follow my commands. We obey the commands of the Lord because we're children of God. We obey the commands of the Lord because they give light to our eyes, because they're right and they're just and they're good. We obey the commands of the Lord because he is holy and we are set apart unto him. And we don't live the way the world lives. We live the way our Father taught us to live. It's time for us to obey the Lord, amen? To be different from the world, to obey the Lord. Listen, we can't claim to be children of God if we're going to live in sin and in darkness. We can't claim to be children of God and go, I know you want me to do this or the Bible says this, but that was meant for those people way back then. You must not mean that now, because God, you got to understand, our world is different nowadays. Surely you can't expect me never to say bad words. Everybody says it. Well, the Bible says, let your speech be pure. Whatever is holy and upright and just and true, think on these things. Oh, well, God, you understand, don't you? Listen, this is where the significant separation comes from those who say they have faith in God to those who actually walk in faith, is that they obey the Lord. John 14 says this, if you love me, you will keep my commands. Did you know obedience was related to love? If we love our Heavenly Father, we're going to say, Lord, out of obedience to you, out of love for you, I'm going to obey what you've asked me to. How many of you, your children, understand everything you ask them to do before they submit to it? How many of your children understand the reason for all of the guidelines and all of the directions you give? And how many as parents, we still expect them to obey them even if they don't understand? Here's your curfew. Here's the keys to the car, but here's the steps I want you to take. Here's the thing. Here's the guidelines. How many of you think, how many of your teenager understands the reason for every command you gave before they obey it? But you still expect what? Obey. Why? Because you have what's good in mind for them. You're watching out for them. And listen, the difference between those who say they believe in God and those who are really God's children, the difference from this world is that we obey the commands of the Lord because we love our Heavenly Father. God, I may not understand why you want this, but I know that you've asked it of me, so Lord, I'm going to submit to you. How many of you have the courage to live that way? That's what God's called us to do, is to trust him. And here's the thing. Many people see God's commands as restrictive. They see God's commands as something that's, it's just, or maybe even it's intolerant. You just don't accept us the way we are. People think God's just going to be okay with whatever we do and go, God would never be that intolerant. God would never not. Let me give you an illustration. A world illustration of this. I was lucky enough to go play golf a couple years ago. I was with Pastor Oscar and a couple other guys, and I was invited to play, and they paid for me to play at a really nice course in San Antonio. And when we got there, it was a beautiful golf course, and I'm not that great of a golfer, but I love to just get out in nature, and it's just beautiful, right? And so I'm playing this beautiful course. I get there, I find out that they require you to have a collared shirt to play. Can you believe that? The audacity of this golf course. That is such discrimination against t-shirt wearing people like me who love t-shirts. You're not getting indignant with me. Let me make my appeal to you guys over here. Can you believe they make you wear a collar to play golf? That is just so discriminatory, because I like my old worn out t-shirt. It has a couple holes right here. It fits me perfectly. I can swing my golf club so much better. You know what? I just have a mind to go tell them off about their collar rule shirt. In fact, I'm not even going to play golf at their course. I cannot believe that they require me to wear a collar on my shirt. I'm going to write a letter to somebody. I think Donald Trump could do something about this. I'm going to go straight to the top on this one. He's going to give them a call, and we're going to correct the situation. How many of you think that was my reaction? Nope. I'm like, let me iron my shirt a little bit, make sure there's no wrinkles in it, and let's put it on. All right, let's go play golf. How many of you know that's what I did? There's rules in every gathering or group of people. There's not a country club I've ever seen that says, yeah, jump in the golf cart. You can go do donuts on the greens and do wheelies out on the golf course. Have a great time. Enjoy yourself. I've never seen a nation or country who says, you don't have to obey our laws. If you live here, you don't have to pay taxes. In fact, you're a visitor. Come on in and do whatever you want. Anybody know a nation like that? How about a movie theater? Anybody been to a movie theater who's like, yes, bring all of your cell phones in, turn them on loud, make the screen really bright when you text? Anybody gone to a theater like that? An athletic team who says, yeah, you can come to practice every other day. That's okay. You don't have to have your uniform at every game. Just do your best. How many of you know organizations like that? Listen, there are rules. And we follow the rules, and we understand that every organization has rules and guidelines. Why? It has shared value. There's a reason why this is our value. Whether your value is looking really good in a polo shirt, or your value is having the same uniform on a team and having unity and playing better, listen, whatever the values are, they're shared values. And so there's rules. There's a willingness to submit to the rules because in the organization in order to receive the benefit of being a part of that organization. Come on, are you getting me, church? Why is it that we treat God like he has to accept us the way we are, regardless of our behavior, and that he cannot have any rules or obligations or requirements in our life? God is a holy God who created us, who knows the rules, knows the guidelines, and has every right to tell us this is the parameters in which you should live. Our obedience to God is a submission saying, God, I want to be a part of your family. I want to be in your goodness and blessing. And by the way, God is a holy God. There's no sin allowed in his presence. God, I don't want to live in sin anymore. I don't want to live in darkness. I want to live in your light. We are called to be a chosen people, God's special possession, no longer living in darkness, but in the wonderful light. There are rules because it's about our shared value. God, we value righteousness. We value your goodness. We value living with purity in the way you've designed us to live. The Holy Spirit is the one who wells us up in us, because without the help of the Holy Spirit, we just don't understand God's shared values. We just don't share those values at all. We're like a rebellious teenager who goes, give me the keys. I don't care what your rules are. I want to go drive the car how I want to. In our fleshly nature, we're like, rules, God, don't tell me what to do. I want to live however I want to. But the Holy Spirit helps us begin to see the goodness of God's guidelines. Any of you come to the place in your life where you realize that God's guidelines are good for you, that they never harm you, that when God said don't envy, he was trying to protect your own heart from jealousy that made you always discontent? That his guidelines of don't commit adultery, how many of you need to watch your families and friends keep going through divorces and hurt and pain to know that adultery is a bad thing? You see, God's commands are to bring light to our eyes. And listen, one of the ways we're different from the world is we just obey the commands of the Lord. Blindly, you follow God? Yes. I don't know how to lead my life without God's guidance. It's like having a three-year-old say, you're supposed to know how to take care of your life at this phase. No, parents teach them, right? And yet before the Lord, how much do I really know of my 43 years of life? How much do I really know about how everything works, and I can order and orchestrate every area of my life, and I don't need any guidance or help? We need the guidance of the Lord. We need to obey the Lord. Listen, if you are relatively new to your faith in God, if you've given your heart back to the Lord recently, within the last number of months, listen, obedience is an expectation of God. You'll understand why over time. You'll understand why sexual immorality is so harmful to you and to those around you over time. At first, you'll be like, oh, that's so restrictive. But over time, you'll like, oh, wait, that's God's goodness in my life. When it comes to God's commands and his laws, listen, the Holy Spirit is going to lead you in this area. And if you push that voice out and you don't submit to God's laws and you don't submit to his commands, listen, you're going to begin to separate yourself from your walk of faith in the Lord, and you're going to walk more into the darkness. Obedience is required of God's people. It's how we're different from the world. People say that they believe in God and believe in things all the time, but those who really have faith in God, they obey the Lord. Amen? Yeah, let's give God praise for his guidance, his direction, his commands. Man, read Psalm 19 sometime. David, he just went off about saying, Lord, like the sun goes from one side to the other every day, and it's faithful. God, your word and your commands and your teaching, they bring light, they bring understanding, they bring wisdom. David began to love the law of the Lord. He said, Lord, I meditate on your law day and night. David came to the realization, wait a minute, God is for me. Read Psalm 19. It'll bless your heart. He's like, God, thank you for your guidance and your commands. When's the last time we thank God for his commands? It's time that we recognize that he's for us and we really submit to him. So we look different from the world by having faith in God, a true faith in God. We look different from the world because we obey God. We do what he asks of us. We step out in faith and trust him. And thirdly, the way we're different from the world is we serve God. We serve God. Not only do we have faith in him and obey him, but Joshua says it this way, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That's not passive. That's not a standing back and going, you know what my position is? Yeah, I believe in him. That's not passive. Joshua said, as for me and my house, that's the direction, we are going in it. I'm going to serve the Lord actively. I'm going to submit my life to the Lord and follow him. Listen, you have to understand something about the nature of how we were created. We were created in God's image. We were created to reflect his glory. That means God's a creative God. God is an active God. God is a moving God. And so when we serve the Lord, listen, God is working. We were made to serve him. We have a purpose in our life, one of our core values. God made us with gifts and talents and things that can reflect his glory through your behavior, through your speech, through your actions. You are made to serve the Lord. And you've got to know something about how you were created, because God is ultimately over all things, and we are the created. We were made under his covering. We were made to serve him and to worship him, to be in a relationship with him. And so listen, if you replace God, you're going to worship something. Something's going to have the allegiance of your heart. Something's going to have the affection of your heart. Something is going to receive your subjugation or your service or your allegiance. It doesn't take very long if you're a kid with sports teams or hobbies to know that when you sign your kids up for sports, you have allegiances, right? You have responsibilities. When you get a hobby in your life, you're going to find real quick that it involves taking your time and it takes your money. Anything that you give yourself to is going to require your allegiance. Why do we have a problem with that with the Lord? Why is serving God so difficult? Didn't our talents and our gifts come from God? Didn't our breath come from the Lord? Why is it such a problem to give my breath back to him? To say, God, here's my life. What do you want me to do? Why would it be so difficult if God called some of us in the room to go, you know what, I want you to just sell your stuff, and I want you to go be a missionary to this country who needs me really, really bad, and I've given you what you need, so just trust me. Why would that be so hard for us? Now, I know most of us in this room will probably never be called to leave this place and go to another. That's a unique calling, but can I tell you that that's what God expects for us here in Laredo? Lord, here's my career, here's my life. What do you want to make of it? What influence can I have being a medical assistant or a records keeper or a clerk or a cashier? Or God, what purpose can my life serve for you here in Laredo? Why would it be so difficult if God gave us these hands that we don't say, God, they're really here to serve you? God made us to be able to give. And here's the great thing about God. Everything in this world that demands your allegiance, you get some satisfaction out of. You put your kids in a sports program and they're going to ask for four nights a week of practice. A traveling team is even more, and you're going to give and give and give, and you might have a reward of a championship or a medal, but once you give, there's no payback. Am I right? There's no refund. There's no, well, let me give you equivalent value back. No, you do it, and if you enjoy it, great. If you win, great. But you just give your allegiance. But how many of you know, when you give to the Lord, the promises, listen, you may be giving to me, but let me tell you something. I'm giving back to you. Come on, when you serve the Lord, he blesses your life. I've got news for you. God doesn't need you to express his love. God chooses to use you. God allows you to participate in his glorious nature of being a giver. God allows you to take the gospel message of grace and love and be a minister of reconciliation. God allows you to bring life to other people. Isn't that a privilege? We have the opportunity to become givers and participate in the divine nature of God by being a giver. Oh, and by the way, when you give, guess what? You get blessed as much as the one you give to. So there's a win on every way in which we serve the Lord. Why is it so difficult then for us to serve the Lord? Why is it so difficult for us to take our time and our resource and our money and the spiritual gifts that God's given us and say, God, here I am, use me. If we're going to be different from this world, if we're going to dare to be different, stand out from the crowd. Listen, we don't have to go like the world is saying and be radically different in our dress or wear different clothing. You know how we can be different? We can serve God. Serve his purposes on the earth. And listen, in giving of our life, we are fulfilled. The Bible says that Jesus gave his life. And listen to what Isaiah tells us. The Bible says he gave his life for ransom for many. And he says, and he suffered, and when he saw the light of life, he was satisfied. That means Christ, after painfully and agonizingly giving his life on a cross and being beaten within an inch of his life with 39 lashes that ripped his flesh off, when after he had given his life, he saw the light of life and was satisfied. He said, God, I have been able to reconcile people to you. How many of you know how much more if we serve the Lord and we help others come to Him? We're not dying for anybody's sins. We're not giving of ourselves from some holy position. We were sinners that have been forgiven and now we get to use our gifts and talents to be redemptive. Come on, give God praise for what He's doing in your life. It's like a three-time felon that strike out that should have spent life in jail but got out and it's like, no, you know what? I'm free. I get to help steer others on the right path. We were made to serve the Lord. And if you read Joshua, the book of Joshua, when the children of Israel were called in the promised land, Moses had passed on and now Joshua had been anointed to lead them. And if you read the story there, it speaks to purpose. It speaks to serving the Lord, saying, God, I'm going to use what I have for you. And if you know the story, Joshua and Caleb, they went out with 10 other spies. There were 12 total. And they went out and they went to the promised land that God had said, this is where I want you to go. And they came back and 10 of the spies go, no, we can't do it. They're too big. The people are too big. It's too hard. We can't accomplish it. But Joshua and Caleb said, no, this is what the Lord has given. That's the land God gave us. We can do this. God is with us. He's on our side. And the difference between the 10 and the 2 was about their perspective. The 10, what they saw is the risk. What they saw was we don't want to potentially give up our lives. We could fight this battle and they could destroy us and we could lose our whole future. And they saw it from the temporary perspective. But Joshua and Caleb, they saw from God's perspective. They said, no, wait a minute. Well, hasn't God been with us from the time He brought us out of Egypt? Hasn't God made a way every single time? Didn't God tell us to go to that land? Don't you think God's big enough to lead us into the land? And so here's what Joshua and Caleb said. I'm willing to risk everything I have to go to battle because God is with me. I'm willing to lead. I'm willing to use my gifts to lead the people into battle. He wasn't like going, yeah, you guys should go do that. No, He said, I'm willing to lead. Let's go. We can do this. We can accomplish this. He said, I'm willing to do whatever it takes to do God's will. That's serving the Lord. Joshua was said, I'm stepping up to the purpose for which God created me. He didn't use those words, but that's what he was doing. You know, some of us have done exactly that. We're sitting in a sanctuary because there's people in this congregation over the past several decades who said, I'm willing to step up. I'm willing to give my time and my resource and my energy and I'm willing to risk it all. There was points of faith. Some of you remember, you've been with us, right, on the journey when we moved from the Robinson building to this place where we worship now, and we believed for expanded ministry. We believed that there would be an increase in ministry. We believed that if we built, that there would be an increase in the work of the Lord through our church, and so we stepped out in faith. We did the whole stepping out and signing on the dotted line and said, listen, we're going to put our money where our mouth is. We're going to sacrifice. Do you remember the times when we signed up for capital campaigns and we had votes? Do you remember? Come on, raise your hand if you remember. You've been here. Testify to us. We stepped up and said, I'm going to serve the Lord. And we're here today seeing the ministry of the Lord because somebody or some group of people stepped out in faith. But there's some of us that still have gifts that God's placed in you that are lying dormant. You have resources and you don't know the joy yet of going all in for the kingdom of God. You have talents, you have creativity, you have time, and none of it is manifesting to build the kingdom of God, at least not to the potential that you have it. Why do I know this? Because if a group this size really went all in together, there is nothing we couldn't do in Laredo for the kingdom of God together. If we came to the table and said, God, my life's in your hands, but you know what? I'm here to serve you, Lord. I'm here to serve your kingdom, your purpose. What do you want from me, God? This city would get turned upside down on its head just from the people in this room. If we all came together and just said, we're all in, God, what do you need from us? We're called to serve the Lord, not just talk about him or see him from a distance. And there's some moments in scripture you can see where God is pretty sobering how he sees us using our gifts. He's like, I've given you these talents. If you bury them, just go read look up the parable of the talents. If you bury your gifts and talents, see how God treats the people, how he responds when he's like, I've given you all this, and what did you do with it? One day we will answer to the Lord. And the way we look different from the world is we have faith in God, we trust him, we obey the Lord, but we also serve the Lord. We say, God, here I am. If I were talking to the graduates right now, I would just look at them in the eye and go, look, your whole future's in front of you. What's your job right now is not to just find the most lucrative career or to try to find the most success. Your job right now is to say, God, I'm going in the direction your life has for me. Would you agree with me in telling our graduates that? But let me challenge you with this. That same message applies to you today. Wherever you are, you have your life ahead of you. You have the rest of your life ahead of you. You can decide, like Joshua, choose this day who you'll serve. Choose this day who's going to have your allegiance, your faith, your real trust. Choose who you're going to obey. Choose who you're going to serve. But as for me and my house, I'm going to serve the Lord.